Now, folks, here we are on the very first day of January 2024. And Happy New Year to you, by the way. And it's my first video that I'm putting together. Now, there's been a thought in my mind for years now about the mass rocks which were in the fields where I was trimming the hedges and even trimmed round the rocks. So I thought I must put that story together because it may be of interest to some folks. So the first question is, what is a mass rock? Well, it's just a natural rock in a field or on the shore, or it could be up a mountain, but we have no mountains down our end of the peninsula. So it's either in a field or on the shore in our case. So that's what a mass rock is, a huge natural, not necessarily huge, but a natural structure in the field. And it was used by the priests in the penal days when there was great persecution against the Catholic folk. And the rock was used kind of as a pulpit or a lectern, what you would have in a church today. And it raised the priest up, his voice carried, and he administered the mass to the congregation, which was gathered out in the open round the rock. So that's what mass rocks are, and I didn't realise it in my early day when I was working round them. Now, the first chapel in Portaferry, the ones we know today, was built at Ballyphillip, the first one, in 1762. And there was one at Ballygalgett as well, built a few years later in 1784. But before those chapels were built, the folks met in what they called a mass house. Now, it was just like a small barn with no gavel in it, even some of them. The congregation just gathered in, the priest ministered from the front, and there was no gavel end in it. So those were very simple structures. They were called mass houses, which were the forerunner of our chapels. And then, before the mass houses, people were meeting in the fields. Now, there was other old churches down the peninsula here, maybe from away from the 1100s. But we are talking about roughly from 1500 to 1800 in that period. And it was a time of great persecution for the Catholic folk especially. Now, the Presbyterians, they were having a hard time as well, but we will leave that for another story on the Covenanters and the Presbyterian side of the story. We're dealing with the mass rocks and the Catholic folk in this series. There may be two or three videos in this, I'm not sure. I don't want them to run too long. Now, my first experience of a mass rock was when my father bought me a hedge cutter, and I was around 17 years old. So we're talking 1970s, early 1970s. And my father bought us a hedge cutter, and I started to cut hedges. I thought that'd be a lovely job out in the open on the farms. So that's what happened. And when my father, who was a vet, was travelling round the upper Ards, round all the farms, in all the farmyards, the farmers heard I had got a hedge cutter, and it would transpire that they would say, "Send your son in to cut our hedges." So my first experience of a mass rock was like this. There's a farm way down at the Barmouth, belongs to a man called John Johnson now. And in the 70s, I think his father was still alive, so it was probably him I was dealing with. So I had gone to cut Mr. Johnson's hedge. Big long lane it is, hedge up each side. And then when you get to the farmyard, you open the gate and go on down the lane further through the farmyard, and it takes you right on to the beach of Strangford Loch, just where what we call the bar mouth, where the water runs out of the loch into the sea. So I was trimming this hedge, and I had gone up through the yard and right down onto the beach, following to the end of the lane. And it was a lovely day. I can remember a lovely sunny day, and the tide was out. So the farmer had been in having his lunch, and he had come down the lane and along the shore field to check the cows. But I was sitting out on the mass rock having my lunch. And the farmer shouts over, because it was about maybe 30, 40 yards away. He says, "Hey boy, you're sitting on the mass rock." And I thought to myself, I froze for a moment. I thought, oh no, just out working from my first jobs, out self-employed. And I thought, have I stood on this man's toes? Have I offended him? And I was kind of very uneasy for a second or two. And then he just waved and walks on. So I was sitting on the mass rock, and we're going to look at it a little later in the programme here, and the other ones, and I'm going to relate to you little stories that affected me as I was working in those areas. After all those years now, here I am, and I've decided why I should really tell the story of those rocks and the significance of them in our Irish history, and just in the locality, and many people don't know about them, even in the Catholic folk. So here we go. Now, I'm going to give you a little introduction of history, just to set the scene and to let you see what it was like in those days. Now, just to give us a flavour of what way things stood in this little country, we have to go back to 1509, when Henry VIII assumed the crown. And we know Henry had so many wives, and he was forcing and cajoling Pope Clement to annul his marriage to Catherine of Aragon, but Pope Clement wouldn't hear of it. So that caused a massive rift. And Henry set himself up then as head of the Church of England, and that was called the Act of Supremacy, and that was introduced in 1534. So Henry's line became head of the Church of England, and that started the English Reformation, which was very bad news for the Catholic folk in Ireland here, and England as well. But in 1536, the dissolution of the monasteries was introduced. That was, again, very bad news. But in spite of Henry's break from Rome, he never became a Protestant. And then, as if that wasn't enough, in 1695, the penal laws were introduced in Ireland here. Now, this wasn't the first introduction of penal laws. Well, Wales had suffered them in the 1400s, at the start of 1400. So, but it was introduced in Ireland in 1695. Here's a few things off the penal laws, a few of the proclamations. You couldn't own a horse over £5. Now, that meant you were going out of an agricultural clip-clop horse to maybe a sport horse. And obviously, all the news was carried by a speedy horse in those days, so they didn't want Catholics owning that if there was any insurrection or anything happening and you had an old cart horse. You couldn't get the news out too fast. So I'm assuming that's what it was. You couldn't own a weapon, even to protect yourself. You couldn't own land. You couldn't inherit land off a Protestant. You couldn't marry a Protestant or vice versa. And you couldn't vote. You weren't allowed to keep a church register of numbers in the church and families, births, deaths. That was a punishable offence too. And you weren't allowed to attend Catholic worship. You could go to the Church of England, or Church of Ireland, sorry, but you weren't allowed to worship in the Catholic manner. And again, as if that wasn't bad enough, in 1697, the Banishment Act was introduced. Bishops, monks, friars, deans, etc., were all given a few months to vacate Ireland. And you were designated a port, if you were near here, say Port of Ogie, Port of Ferry, whatever, and you were seen onto the boat and put out of the country. Now, if you returned, tried to get in the back door and were caught, you were imprisoned for a year. If you tried it again, it was seen as treason. So that's just giving you a little flavour of what things were like. Now, in that same period, I want to introduce you to a character called Bishop Patrick Donnelly. He was born 1650 and lived to 1716. I think that's about 66 years, if I'm not correct. And Bishop Patrick Donnelly ministered in the district of South Armagh during that turbulent and tumultuous period. How did he do it? Well, he dressed up as a minstrel and he played the Irish harp, the small harp that you can carry. And he went to the fairs, round the villages in disguise and ministered his priestly duties. Now, there's a song about Bishop Patrick Donnelly, and he had a pseudonym. It was Phelim Brady. So, and he was referred to as the Bard of Armagh. So this is a little song about him. I think it's written with his own hand, and you'll recognise the tune. I'll play it for you now.
Oh, list to the lay of a poor Irish harper, and scorn not the strains of his old withered hands. But remember his fingers, they once could move sharper, to raise up the memory of his dear native land. At a fair or a wake, I could twist my shillelagh, or trip through a jig with my brogues bound in straw. And all the pretty callings around me assembled, the bold Phelim Brady, the Bard of Armagh. And when Sergeant Death with his cold arms embrace me and lull me to sleep with sweet Erin Gobran, by the side of my Kathleen, my young wife, then place me, forget Phelim Brady, the Bard of Armagh. Thank you.
We're now at the townland of Billy Duck. That we were always told this was the site for the Marsh Rock, better known as Carrick na Hurder. This was the time the priests were hunted. We think around the 1700s, we're not just sure that there. But it's a lovely site, and you've lovely scenery around you. There's Rock Angus, Collard Point, and Cleve Castle in the Warren Mountains. What a lovely spot it is too. And you go ahead now.
Well, one of the reasons that we're not sure of the dates, or to be sure this is the Mass Rock, that in the penal days, the idea of keeping records would have been dangerous, to say the least. Could have cost you your life, I am led to believe. Apart from that, I'm only repeating what I've been told over the years. We moved up here in 1950, I'm led to believe, John, wasn't it? Yeah, I was only a baby at that stage, of course. Like, you know, you would remember it much better than me.
Yeah. Looking around me here at the moment, the tide is approaching quite rapidly. Bearing in mind the erosion over the years, this Mass Rock must have been a lot closer to the land than what it is today. Leaving it would have been in an ideal position as far as well out of the way, close to the water for a quick escape, because I assume that in the penal days, boat was probably the main mode of transport. That's an assumption, by the way.